May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be always pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Take a seat. Did we turn this off entirely? No, it's still going. No, whatever. Okay. So, I feel like we're doing a series at the moment on why the Bible is more complicated than some people think. Because we've just it just keeps coming up. And today's gospel passage is a really beautiful example of why, quite often, Scripture is more complex than people think, and yet has so much depth in it that there is profound things for us to learn. And in today's gospel reading, there are at least three broad understandings of what's going on. And the one you pick is quite often determined by other stuff that's going on. It's determined by your picture of who Jesus is, the culture and environment from which he and his disciples come, maybe what you want to say about Jesus. So, let's go with the first of the three pictures. I'm trying to remember which order I was going to do. Never mind. So, have you ever phoned someone and left a message on their answering machine? Have you ever listened to that message back? You go, I don't sound like that. Yeah. You see, in my head, I sound like James Earl Jones. You know? He's got this beautiful, deep, sonorous voice, and you listen to the recording, it's like, that's not me. Sometimes having ourselves shown back to ourselves is quite an important thing. And one picture here is that there's this Canaanite woman, she's come up, and the disciples are treating her in a way that is fairly reprehensible. Send her away, she's annoying. We've got more important things to do. More important things. And one picture here is that Jesus operates as a mirror of their behavior. He says, you know, it's not fair that the bread be thrown to the dogs. This is what you look like. This is the kind of behavior you are. And he, as a teacher, he is showing them their behavior. And then he models a better behavior when he heals the child. That's one picture. And if that's the picture you go with, it's a really strong encouragement, invitation, command for us as followers of Jesus to reflect on our own tendency to think we have more important things to do than to help those around us. We have more important things to do than to cross the barriers that our culture puts in place, because the Canaanite woman would not have been socially acceptable in that environment. I wonder what you think of that picture. Another picture. There's a sign going around on the internet, and it's there's a billboard that's been set up. It's encouraging men to go to the doctor to get themselves checked out. And on it, it says, this year, 32,000 men will die of stubbornness. Because, you know what men are like, right? It's, we are fine unless it's man flu. Look, and if it's man flu, that's it. It's over. We expect sympathy and hot soup and bed. Man flu is worse than giving birth to children. maybe not. But when it comes to other things, quite often men are going, I'm fine, it's just a flesh wound, you know. And somebody's written underneath it, no, we won't. Sometimes our pride and our comes between us and what we need. Sometimes our pride prevents us from reaching out for help. And this woman, she's there, and it would be very easy for her pride to get between her and her access to Jesus. He's not describing her in a particularly positive and affirming manner in the first instance. She's being described as a dog. That's not a compliment back then, I assure you. And yet, what she does is she models a faith that is greater than her pride. Or maybe she models a love for her child that is greater than her pride. Maybe she models a hope and healing that is greater than her pride. Whatever it is, she models stepping over that boundary of not letting her own foolish pride and stubbornness get in the way of her access to God. And if that's the story you want to go with, there's a pretty clear message in there about what we should do with our own pride, with our own stubbornness, with our own refusal to seek assistance, because certainly we all need it some days, don't we? We all need a bit of help sometimes. If we recognize that we need help, sometimes we can recognize that other people need help too. The third picture is, for a lot of people, I suspect, is the most challenging. But it's also, for me, the most hopeful. And that's a picture that says, even though Jesus is God with us, God incarnate, sometimes he also makes mistakes. See, we don't like to say that, do we? We don't like to say, well, maybe Jesus got it wrong. That's a really difficult moment. Maybe Jesus was like his disciples at the start of this little excerpt from Matthew's gospel. Maybe Jesus actually did go, look, I've got more important things to do. I've got to focus on bringing the kingdom of God to all of Israel, and there's a lot of people, and they're not listening very well at the moment. So, look, I've got something else to do. Talking to the Canaanite woman. We've all been, well, I've been. Maybe I shouldn't speak for you. But I know I've been there. It's like, oh, I've got to get the parish returns done. I've got to get the pew bulletin sorted. Somebody's got to cook dinner. Not now. We've all been there, haven't we? Why? And yet, her response, which is this raw response of need, is enough that Jesus actually goes and he reorients on her and says, wow, you've got great faith. You've got more faith in God right now, perhaps, than even I do. You've got more faith in God's ability to reach out than even I do. Your request is granted. Child is healed. If even Jesus can make a mistake and yet still be the greatest example of God's love and grace, and what about us? You know, because we get things wrong all the time. And sometimes they're mistakes. Sometimes they lack of care. Sometimes it's just we do the things we should not do. You know, St. Paul, I know what I should do. And I don't do it, and I know what I shouldn't do, and yet I do. If even in his moment of error, Jesus can be a sign of God's grace, how about us? How much can we be examples of God's grace if we are able, when we are confronted by our error, see them, to reorient ourselves back in the line of God's mercy and healing, and to continue to be examples of God's love. So for me, I like that third one the most. But the important thing scripturally is that all three of those pictures are there. They're all there. Isn't it an amazing thing that our scriptures, although they are complex, they've got many voices in them, have so much to teach us as long as we are willing to read, to think, to pray, and be open to God's grace. Then we will be agents of God's healing and God's love. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.